Thanks everyone for coming and spending your Saturday morning here and a little bit of your afternoon. There are many pictures, so I'll move pretty quickly. I live in San Francisco. I grew up in Boston. I've been here since the year 2000. That's the route that I took, roughly speaking. It was a 4,257-mile bike ride. It took about 8 weeks, 55 days. I took a few days off in that period, too. Across four time zones, went through a few deserts, over some mountain chains, and I was alone. I couldn't really convince anybody to go with me in that in the short period of time that I spent getting ready for the trip. I was 38 during the trip. I'm 39 now. I do have out of shape bike ride on Facebook because that's what I was and what I'm now back to being a year after the trip. I'm an engineer. When I was in high school, I used to bike to libraries, and gradually I got to the libraries of, say, 30 towns in eastern Massachusetts and a couple of other places. I have bad knees, probably from running track in high school, and I really just started biking again in the year 2009. My day job is pretty much sitting in my chair, staring at my computer screen or at things that I'm drawing at my desk. This is a part of a flood barrier on the east side of New Orleans. It was built after Hurricane Katrina. This right here is about 2.5 stories above the waterway. That's what's protecting eastern New Orleans from the next set of hurricanes. In 2009, when I started biking in San Francisco, I picked up this book. And because I was born as sort of a fascist, and I like to follow rules and not get killed on the road, I have this with me that I'm carrying all the time so that I avoid getting doored and, you know, going on the inside of somebody who's turning right and getting run over that way. I'm also a map fetishist, so I like to draw the places I go in San Francisco. That's hanging on my fridge. If you follow that book, this is pretty much what you'll cover in the city. I started thinking about getting a new bike at the end of 2012. And I'm a cheap Yankee, so I really suffered some sticker shock thinking about a $600 road bike. I wanted something fast. But I gradually started thinking, well, I'll get a bike that can handle the load of traveling across the country. Maybe in a few years, I'll give it a shot. I also started buying some of the equipment at the end of 2012 and beginning of 2013, and started sniffing around to see if anybody would go with me. And April, about 2 months before I actually went on the trip, I decided I would give it a shot. Let's see, May 14th, 2 weeks before the trip, I bought this bike. So I had 2 weekends of loaded practice. So prior to loading this bike up on May 17th or so, I had never had a bike with all this weight on it. June 1st, I started the ride, mainly because it's easier to keep track of time. Day 1, June 1, day 2, June 2. I got to go through these 13 states. And we'll roll through those, and you'll see some of the pictures that I took when I was out on the road. So as you get into Sacramento, there's this lovely bridge. It's gold on one side. It's yellow on the other side. The American River. Start to see a little bit of the water that you have in the west, the first of the great rivers that I got to cross. If you make a wrong turn and you leave your route, you get to see Folsom Dam. 1.5 miles downhill, 1.5 miles back uphill. I had just read a book called The Egyptian. It's a novel about the time of King Tut before this trip. So anytime I saw a hawk, it was the god Horus smiling upon me. Unfortunately, a bird can't really smile, so next time I'll pick a different god. This was day three up in the Sierra Nevada. The first day of trying out my girlfriend's tent, my air mattress, my new sleeping bag, see if my new stove worked, pots and pans, freeze-dried food. There's a lot of stuff that was bought brand new for the trip. So this is the first day that I got to camp. There's the stove in action. It fits in the palm of your hand. I will mention, middle of the night, I had to wake up because my tent was surrounded by water from the road crews, spraying water on the road to keep the dust down. So I had to pick up the tent and walk it over, put it back down, crawl back inside. This is getting close to Carson Pass. This is the hardest part of the trip, day 4. Again, I didn't have much exercise before the trip, so creeping up to 8,574 feet above sea level took a little bit of work. Also, there was some thunder, some rain. I wasn't sure which pieces of clothing to put on because it was sometimes pelting me and other times completely dry. This is on the backside. If you look carefully, you can see a little bit of the mist on the road. That's actually from the precipitation hitting it. These are the trip profiles. The first 4 of them show what you have to go through in order to get east of the Rocky Mountains. So that one there is day 4 up at the top. That's Carson Pass. In Nevada, now I didn't open the Nevada map until maybe the week before the trip. Okay. So I thought, I know Nevada. Nevada is high up there. That's elevation 4,000. You see how flat that is? It's high, but it's flat, right? So then a week before I open it up and I see it's not flat. Okay. So it's about 4, if you count them, it's about 14 mountain ranges that you have to cross when you go through Nevada. The worst bit, or so I thought, was in here climbing up from Cedar City. You go up about 1 mile in elevation over the course of 2.5 hours of biking. Yeah. And people love to say, okay, you're east of the Rockies, you're free of all this stuff, it's easy. Until you get to Missouri, and then you get this heart monitor here. Those are the Ozark Mountains, and they're basically as steep as what you have in Utah. They just don't last as long. So you go up 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and then you have a roller coaster down. 10 minutes, 20 minutes. You do that 100 times in the day, and you're done with that day. So these little notes here are the days where I was in each spot. Little arrows where I stopped. On this day, it was 116 miles of up and down. So Nevada's a lot of fun. If you ride your bike from here in about 5 days, you can be out in the desert. This is Carson City, same bike. Oh, that's when I called up work and emailed people and told them what I was doing. So I told work I was leaving for 100 days. I was tired. I didn't mind if they asked me at that point. A little bit stressed out, but I needed to take the adventure of a lifetime and kind of go for it. So I said I'd be out for 100 days, but I didn't tell most people what I was up to. At this point, I had some credibility. I had crawled over the mountains, and I felt, I don't have to slink back and with my tail between my legs and say, well, I tried and failed, 2 days out. So secret was out, and then after that, I had vacation. So 8 to 12 hours of pedaling in the day, 51 to 120 miles per day. The average on a riding day in the second month was 92 miles per day. So this was at the end of a 97-mile day. And some people said, you should just ride your bike around for another 3 miles in order to get a 100-miler. But I was tired. When you're out there, it looks like that. You don't see a lot of cars in some places. You might see 7 or 8 cars in an hour in a few spots. Choose a reliable vehicle. The Navy was out there in the middle of the desert, which seems a bit weird. I'm glad I got to the one eating place before they did. A whole bunch of them showed up just after. That's one of the mountain ranges that's coming up. This is 95 miles into Churchill County, Nevada. There is some plant life. I wouldn't exactly call it greenery. And dust devils. See a lot of dust devils swirling around. Sometimes you end up passing through them, only a couple of times. And you climb up one of these mountain ranges, and then you go downhill for 10 miles, 15 miles, maybe even 20 miles. It is so much fun. The whole time, if you're like me, you're humming Judas Priest songs and whatnot. Very heavy on the guitar. I don't really sing on the other side. I just keep on going. See some interesting architecture in the West. And this place, I was just about to cross into Utah. I got up a little bit before dawn to try to avoid the sun. And the road was covered in animals, live animals, rabbits, and some other fluffy things. And got this view around dawn, the last view of Nevada. And crossed my first time zone boundary. You know, lodgings in Utah aren't quite the same as San Francisco. I didn't stay there. This thing will keep you alive in the West. It is the best food on earth. This is a chocolate and peanut butter milkshake. You can eat as many of those as you like on these bike rides. If you want to lose weight, this is a great way to lose weight. If you don't have any to spare, you better put these away whenever they're available. Look like an old mine shaft. Gotta be careful out there. It's a really a strange thing. You do see a lot of animals that didn't make it, and how quickly the inside turns into what looks like soil is marvelous. So there you go. Try not to exceed the speed limit on these uphills. This is that steepest, longest climb part that I was worried about. So 15 miles essentially up, but it is gorgeous. Also, when you're out there, you're out on your own, the motorcyclists see you, the drivers see you, they realize it's 50 miles to the next town. People tend to be pretty friendly. You'll get waves and thumbs up and whatnot. You start to see some of the orange and white bands in the rock there. Getting closer to the top, and then you get a reward. So this is Cedar Breaks National Park. And so the elevation before that, starting in the morning, was about 5,000 in Cedar City. And there's no point taking a ride like this, theoretically getting some exercise and then coming back with skin cancer. So you should try to protect yourself. A lot of people out on the road, not that there are a lot of people doing this, but they look like lobsters. They're red. So it's good to have sun protective clothes that are breathable, wick the sweat away, and keep the dust out. Don't show the drivers that you're upset with them. This is Bryce Canyon. You can see some of the hoodoos in the upper left. One of the nicest campsites was in Tropic, Utah. So you can see the one-man tent that I had borrowed for the trip. See my panniers. This is my usual setup. I would tend to chain up the bike to whatever objects were available after I had unloaded it. Let's see, this is Escalante or Grand Staircase National Park. As I was riding along, I snapped this picture as part of what I felt was my obligation just to take a picture of the thing. But with all the other scenery, it was just, it's not so great compared to some of the other places that I've been. But you get back and you realize as you go through the photos that really it's thousands of miles of some great scenery. Even your subpar shots are pretty attractive. Neil he's about 59, so he's about 20 years my senior. He started a day after me, and we met in Middle Gate, Nevada, and we were sort of leapfrogging. Typically, when we're out west in the deserts, we would meet at the end of the day. You don't have many places that you can stop. In fact, there was a series of 3 days where I was concerned logistically, how much water do you carry, how much food, what if there's an emergency. So the first of those 3 days, it was about 65 miles of riding. All right, I could handle that, I had enough water. The next day was about 75 miles of riding. All right, did that. And the next day, it was about 80 miles before I stopped. And it's basically without any gas stations, without any houses, no artifacts at all, no water sources. You're on your own, carrying your 2 gallons or 15 and a half pounds of water in the bike. One of the nice things is, and it's represented by this picture of Neil here, is that this is more of an adventure than some kind of crazy exercise fanaticism. You get to see the country, you get this experience that you sort of, you take ownership of it. And if you have the right bike with the right gears, you can do it without killing yourself, without grinding your knees to dust and all that. Neil just crossed the country, the continent for his third time this summer. He went across Canada. That's me, and I'm smiling because I'm going to go down that. Some bikers took this picture. Motorcyclists. And you can see the road that I get to go on here, winding its way along. Close up, mostly bare rock. Another close up. Now in this place, this motel, I never, not this motel, hold on, this is much older. I'm just hiding the previous one because it has my credit card info. But that envelope there is where you leave the money at the hotel. I never saw any staff. So that's in Boulder, Utah. You show up, you pick up some keys that are hanging on the door and an envelope. And you stick your money in there, you write your credit card info, have a great time, wash your clothes in the sink as I usually do, hang them out on the bushes. And that was that, very straightforward transaction. The next day, I went across the street and visited some Anasazi ruins. This is always nice when you're going down to see that. Usually what I would do is work my way up a hill, and if I took a break, I'd take a break at the top of the hill, snack, eat my M&Ms with peanuts or Slim Jims, whatever keeps in the bags, and then cruise down for 10 miles and get warmed up again. Also, at the tops of the mountains is when your phone might work. In the deserts, down in the Great Basin, the mountains tend to block your cell phone reception, even in some towns. This is as I'm getting into Capitol Reef National Park. And this is really, I didn't take enough pictures here because I was just enjoying the stunning beauty of it. It was probably the best part of the trip, the most beautiful scenery. Also, it was mostly downhill for 20 miles. Reason it's called Capitol Reef is because these rocks kind of look like the Capitol building in Washington, allegedly. I met a really nice family when I took a break in Capitol Reef. I was getting more water at the visitor center. And they chatted with me, they asked some questions and stuff, and then I paused here, fortunately not to pee on the side of the road, but just to drink water. And they passed me, and they're honking their horns and waving out the window, really nice folks. The next day they did the same thing. They happened to stay in the same town, apparently, and they caught up with me around Lake Powell. So. Factory Butte, really looks like a factory to me. Now, I got to this campsite, and there were two rabbits there. They were there first, they weren't leaving. So, they just hung out. It's a piece of bare rock that was along the trail. Now, when you get this kind of vista, you realize you're just out in it. It's you, there's not much else, it's so bare. If you look ahead and you peer closely, you can see the bridge that you have to cross next as you kind of wind around that away. This is approaching the Colorado River. I think that's called Devil's Gulch or Devil's Creek. That's my campsite in San Juan County, Utah. Utah is a really beautiful place, but hot, dangerous in terms of heat stroke. So you have to have your water, you have to have some salt in your body, some electrolytes, and take it as easy as possible. Maybe don't carry a backpack so that your clothes can allow your sweat to evaporate and keep you a little bit cooler. But there's no question that it's hot, and you either take a break at this point after 50 miles, or you have to go 125, 150 miles to the next stopping place. So I got here early, set up my really hot tent, did my laundry in the sink. There was nobody else camping there. There was this guy, one of the lizards. That's the view from the tent. That's the lake. There's no water in it. So it's very risky to launch your boat here, and be careful of the mussels. Any mussel that can handle that, you do not want to mess with. Okay. So the next day, after not sleeping too well, a van pulled in at 1 a.m, figured I was going to get murdered. Fortunately, I had to use my Army Survival Manual to make a feel expedient weapon the night before. I had sort of a morning star made of a rock in my clothesline, but there was no problem. This note here, somebody left a gallon jug unopened along the roadside for me. And the note is, saw you on your bike. I've been backpacking, so I can only imagine your thirst. Enjoy the white car. Yeah. So I drank as much of that as I could, put the rest in my water bags and bottles, and of course, packed out the garbage. Here's a cactus with some waxy flowers that I thought was pretty. See a bunch of those. And some cliff dwellings. First cliff dwellings that I had ever seen. This is on a nice 10-minute one-way hike. You come back and some people have left some things in your helmet for you. My camera was acting up there, so. This Frenchman was riding kind of a loop all around the west. And you can see that he has a trailer on his bike rather than the saddlebags or the panniers that I have. And yeah, there's a French flag on his on the tail. You can go pretty fast in some places, up to 54 miles per hour. And I should say, if you do have some questions, you can chime in. Let's see, minimum speed about 2.9 miles per hour. A little bit slower than walking, maybe not slower than walking pushing this up a hill, but.
How many flat tires did you
have? I had one flat tire, and I had one slow leak that I didn't even recognized for a little while, because the next day I had to replace my tires anyway. After 3,000 miles, which was too late, you could see the rear wheel was worn down to the next color of rubber. It's hard to see it with the mud guard there and the bags along it and whatnot, and I thought I had a little bit more time, but I didn't. So I got a slow leak around Kentucky, and I got my one flat in New York, the second to last state. So a little green piece of glass, you know. It was rainy. Fortunately, I had some place I could pull over and pretty easily take the wheel off and change it. So it's not a prairie dog, they tell me. It's a ground squirrel. So you can see his head pointing this way. You can see his little shoulders. He has friends. They squeak a lot. One of them tries to distract you, and the others run away. Not fast enough sometimes. That wasn't me, but it was the only way I could get a close-up was to take a picture of a defunct one. In the bag, there are some clothes for cold weather as well, just in case. I was above the snow in some places. I kind of felt bad about taking a picture of this because this is a reservoir, it's man-made. It's not natural beauty, but I thought it was still pretty nice. And here I am reaching the highest point of the trip, crossing Monarch Pass in the Rocky Mountains. And so this van, I'm coming up behind this van, and on the back it says, "Follow me to Jesus" in big letters. And I see the two men, there's another man somewhere here. They look like they're appreciating the beautiful vista of all these mountaintops. And then I pass them and I look back. And I'm like, not following you anywhere today. So again, get a reliable vehicle. Maybe only two wheels to look after and this engine or something. But this is about 30 seconds from the top. Fortunately, there was a place you could buy radiator fluid and get on this way again. But it's about 2 miles up, 11,312 feet. Colorado housing is not quite the same as San Francisco either. But it mashes the mountains. After you're through the mountains, you look back. This is the Rocky Mountains. Yeah, wow. So just looks like a table, a lot of points on the table. And in the west, it's full of fences, barbed wire and posts. I didn't go there, but there are two museums somewhere out west. One is a post museum and another one is a barbed wire museum. I'm not making that up. Oh, there's also dust. Barbed wire, dust, posts. Not too many animals. Yeah. Moving from the west to the east, I thought I'd have a prevailing west wind pushing me. It doesn't really work that way. You get a south wind, you get a north wind, sometimes you get an east wind. But the wind won't help you too much no matter where you go. You're always going to be muttering bad things under your breath. You don't necessarily get cell reception, as I mentioned. And even if you're staying in motels, there may be no washing machine in the town, at the motel, anywhere. So you end up doing the sink laundry thing. I have one shirt. That's the shirt. Every night it got, well, almost every night, got washed, usually by hand. I'm carrying a sink plug. Kansas. I ran into another rider out there that told me that another rider had given up in Kansas out of boredom. I don't know. I'm easily entertained. I focus on all the things that are going on. Cross another time zone, check that off my list. The horses come over, they look at me, they're curious. The horses come towards you. The cows usually walk away, they run away. Saw some cows running in Nevada because they didn't know what I was. But there's a lot to look at in Kansas. Pump jacks, seems, the farms are few and far between, but it seems that everybody has a pump jack taking oil from the earth. You get interesting scenery. There are some buildings. If you like peanut butter, this is a marker related to George Washington Carver. And I like peanut butter in my shakes, so. This was the tallest building in the West for a long time, I think. At least that's what the sign said. If you've read Animal Farm, this could happen. A lot of action going on. If you get behind one of those, it's really helpful to have this over your mouth. Somewhat helpful. I did get behind one. Got a face full of whatever comes out the back of the combine harvesters. See all kinds of crops. You smell the fresh cut hay, it's sweet. You meet your second cousin once removed. I'm a genealogy buff, so that's how we know each other. You see fires. You get to sleep in a church. The pastor invited me, go ahead, just spread out right on the benches, on the pews. That's my sleeping bag up front. Is this okay? Yeah, it's fine. There you go. There's the bike the next morning. Rolling into this town, I looked at my maps. It said, in this town, you can sleep outside the church. So I called them. I was about 10, 20 miles away. And on the phone, he said, no, it's full of ticks. Sleep inside the church, or stay inside of a house. Okay. And then when he was leading me around, he was having me duck. You have to duck. There are trees all over the place, and they're just full of ticks. It's an interesting place. There are about 97 people lived in this town. Okay, if you like the Billy Joel song that talks about white wall tires, this was a part of a 12-mile detour because a bunch of bridges were shut down. Wildlife. Scorched earth. I didn't know we still practice slash and burn agriculture in this country, but maybe we do. This could have been a lightning strike, but I think some of this was intentional. A lot of cereal. After this part of the trip, I really wanted to eat some shredded wheat. Missouri. And more cattle and some horses. and we're starting to get into the Ozarks. There's a dip, and there'll be another rise, and do that for 80 or 100 times. One town had a little store associated with the gas station. They didn't sell any breakfast cereal. That's what I tend to eat in the morning. So that day, I was stuck with graham crackers and my usual milk and maybe some of those M&Ms. After Missouri, or Eastern Missouri, I was winging it. I no longer was on an adventure cycling route. Prior to that, I was following the Western Express route. So that took me to Pueblo, Colorado. And then I got on the Transamerica route, which is the most typical route for crossing from crossing the country. And then I wanted to go to St. Louis. So I would write down the directions from Google Maps, just on a piece of paper, the day before. You'll see those slips of paper in my map case on the bike. And just follow those. And turn off my phone, as was my practice, because its battery would disappear very, very quickly. That meant walking through some creeks. You can kind of see it in the sun there. This maybe was looking back after I'd taken my shoes off and walked the bike through the water. Part of the payoff in St. Louis, when you are 10 miles out of town, this dominates the skyline. It's a beautiful stainless steel structure. It's 600 something feet tall. The cross section at the bottom is a triangle. I'm an engineer, okay. The cross section at the bottom is 51 feet on a side, 17 feet on a side at the top. They built it in the 60s. Nobody died building it. They look very nonchalant building it without any helmets and up there, 60 stories above the ground.
And you zigzag up it in little
eggs. Yes, yes.
It's very nice.
It feels like you're in a Jetsons episode. With your four closest friends crammed into those windowless yellow capsules. Yeah. So there it is. And again, you can see it there. Here I'm standing on top of something that many people haven't heard of, but it's the largest archaeological site north of Mexico. It's called Cahokia, and it has 100 earthen mounds built 1,000 or 2,000 years ago by the Native Americans. And it's just 10 miles out of St. Louis, back in town. Gleaming stainless steel, and then it turns to gold near sunset. There. So there are some windows up in the top. And then, fireworks. This was just after the 4th of July. The next day was pretty fun because it was the day of three states. So very good for your ego. You get to do some Missouri, some Illinois, move on into Kentucky. Eads Bridge is the first bridge across the Mississippi River. It's a big thing for civil engineers like me. So rode across that and into some decrepit, formerly paved roads with some nice countryside. Yeah.
When you go across the bridge, did you have to own the lane, basically?
Yes. Yes. No. Stay away from sidewalks, and if you can avoid bike paths, all that sort of stuff, they're just too slow. They're not made for long-distance travelers. So, yeah, get out in the middle of the lane so that you're telegraphing to the drivers that you're not sharing the lane in that case. It's just too dangerous. Yeah. I'll say about drivers, there are three types of drivers when you're out there on these empty roads, particularly in Nevada. A good percentage give you a wide berth across the yellow line, give you some extra margin in case you fall off. Most drivers, if you wake them up a little bit, they'll give you that wide berth when the road is empty. I spent a lot of time doing sort of a one-arm backstroke thing going like this, very, very largely saying move around, and then they would wake up and they'd go, oh, okay, the road's empty, and they would move over. But then there's that last 5-10% who pass you with a foot to spare. There's nothing you can do about them. Sometimes I left the road because they were too close. One guy was passing some traffic. He had three cars to pass in an otherwise empty road. I think it was Ohio. He came over to my lane and was coming right at me in his pickup truck. And I'm like, get off the road. So, yeah. Here is a stern wheeler. You can see the paddle wheel in the back of this boat. That's the Ohio River. And Kentucky. A little bit blurry, about to cross some crazy, dangerous high bridge into Kentucky. If you've read Uncle Tom's Cabin, apparently Uncle Tom lived there. That's the site of the cabin. Rained a whole bunch here. I was very lucky. I ducked out of it just as it started into a supermarket and spent like 2 hours staying away from the downpour, and then rode in the mist. This was the first and only time I saw pigs on the trip, about three of them. Pigs. Yeah. See other things too, not just livestock. You see marmots. You see a lot of lizards, a lot of flying grasshoppers, very few mosquitoes, and not where I would expect them. Here's some of the runoff from that storm. My girlfriend kept wishing that I would get a downpour, some horrible storm, so that I would have a story to tell afterwards, so that I would suffer a little bit. So, after 3,000 miles, this is what the tires look like. Rear tire with all the weight on it. Front was pretty far gone too. And the sides of the tires crack a little bit, given how they flex under your load as the tire goes around. So I had planned to rotate my tires partway through the trip, but at this point I just got rid of both of them and replaced them. Here's another paddle boat. Another fire. In Colorado, you got to see Chinook helicopters flying around, looking for all the smoke and fire. The air was full of smoke. You could smell it, taste it in your mouth. The day before apparently had been worse. I mean, you would end up with soot on you. So I was luckier than some other people who are passing through the fire area. The Ohio River. I crossed the Ohio River four times, so this is one time when I was going south of the river. Let's see, out in Kentucky. You see a lot of abandoned houses around the country, maybe from farms consolidating or the next generation moves away, moves to the city. It's a little bit depressing. It's interesting, it's something to look at. Ohio does such a terrible, yeah.
How many days did you take off?
Let's see, I rode for 49 and a half days, and I took breaks on 5.5 days. So total, I was out there for 55 days. Yeah. So 1 day in 10. And my first break, I think, was on day 13 in Cedar City before that big climb. One of the important resources that is not listed in the adventure cycling maps is a back rub. If you can get a massage somewhere, that's pretty good. And I did that in Cedar City. Aerial view of the bike. Now, this guy over here is Serpent Mound. It's about 1/4 mile long, and it sort of looks like a snake swallowing an egg that's too big for it. And that's why I was in Ohio. So it's really hard to see the whole thing. The head is up there at the far end. This is 1,000 or 2,000 years old. And Ohio is full of these Native American sites. Hopewell Indians all over the place. All this mound building culture. It was just a rich site. You can imagine the rich agricultural land. And they also had very interesting artwork, like carved into mica. But we don't know too much about them, just what they left behind and what's essentially their cemeteries. This was probably built as a cemetery by these Indians. Each one of those mounds is a place where they had a house and they cremated people and had some rituals. And after a while, they stopped using that particular point and built a mound over it. And there's the mound, one of the mounds. And out on the roads of Ohio, enjoying modern culture. Where is it? There we go. Another one. Pretty neat. I was following part of the Underground Railroad route. It's another adventure cycling mapped route. And sometimes I left it because it seemed to meander a bit too much. But for the most part, I was trying to follow the Ohio River, get into Ohio, and work my way north. And half of Ohio, maybe more than half, was just winging it. From then on, I was just getting my Google Maps directions, writing them down on slips of paper, taking free maps from Ohio from motels when I had them. Some nice looking all-American towns, I would say. I keep telling myself I'm going to look up some of what these signs are. They're probably genetically modified, serial-numbered crops that you can buy.
Or they weren't like the freeways like we have?
No, I would look back and forth between the car directions and the walking directions. And you can really go on almost any of the US routes with the black and white signs. You can't go on the interstates, but you can go on almost everything except for the interstates. If you read some of bicycling history, you'll find that a lot of these high-quality roads were actually built as part of the movement 100-something years ago by bicyclists to get quality paved roads. So. Oh, sorry. There's some more earthworks. This is, 1,700 feet across this here. There's a golf course built into this now. They maintain that. It's 2 or 4 miles across this whole thing. It takes a little while to ride from this part of it over there to another great circle. These are probably not cemeteries, but great ritual centers. We don't know what they did there. Soccer, dancing, who knows. Maybe that's how they figured out who to bury in the fancy cemeteries. In this culture, it seems they had very small settlements, just little villages. And somehow they selected some of their best people to cremate. Not everybody got cremated and chucked into the cemeteries, but there must have been some basis for that. It's hard to imagine sort of a chieftainship or something with so small settlements, but oh well. There's the golf course. More of Ohio. This one, it's another case where I didn't really think I should take a picture of this because it's sort of fake, okay? This bridge was knocked down, I think, in the 90s when the river rose too high and they rebuilt it. So it doesn't really count as this ancient covered bridge. Still looks nice. So, more housing. And another thing I wanted to see on this trip was the Great Lakes. And this is Lake Erie. A little bit of Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is kind of small with tiny trees, a lot of them. Big airplanes back there. And some riders from Canada. This family really fascinated me. There are three kids there. Everybody's on a bike. They're not really a bike, a trike, a tricycle. Recumbent tricycle. So you see the two front wheels there. And you see the father's wheel is bare, balding like my wheel. They're quite early in their trip. But he says that he adjusted the angle of the wheels and stopped wearing down. You lie back in that seat. You've got these pedals here, so your feet up in front of you as you go along. Now, Scarlett, the youngest one, is being towed by Dad. I think it's kind of hard to see her in that packaging there. The two kids, if you ask them, well, you know, what are you doing on this trip and stuff? And our parents made us go. 1,000 miles later, I found an article on the web, and the reporters asked them, our parents made us go. They're still saying it the whole way. Let's see, the daughter is 12, the son, I think, 11, or maybe 13 and 12. But I asked them if they felt they had gotten stronger from this, and son said no, daughter said yes. There they are. And everybody's got a trailer. There's looks like a car seat. Bags here, like my bags. A lot of weight. Nice thing about this kind of bike is it's more efficient than an upright bike. But it's harder to be seen, perhaps. And in fact, the wife was hit by a car sometime along their journey. She's all right. I guess they got a new bike. The bike was heavily damaged. But yeah, you know, these they're fast, but there's a little bit of a trade-off. They're also kind of wide, and drivers are probably freaked out by seeing them. Here, you can see the sun's rigged pretty well. And as I said, little Scarlett, who's about 4 years old, is in that carrier. Oh, and they had sold all their stuff. They were traveling through Texas and Florida and kind of all along the east. So New York. Got some not quite offshore wind farms in New York. Nice houses. Somebody told me I was crazy near this house because it was hot and sweaty out, 100 degrees or whatever. Boring people. But actually, one place where I took up my thermometer and measured the temperature back in Utah at that campsite, it was 105 degrees at 6 p.m. So it did get pretty toasty. But I generate my own breeze by paddling some places. A lot of birds. Some interesting architecture. And first cousin once removed. Also somebody I know from genealogy. And the rain, the pouring rain, it finally got me. I have the rain gear for legs and upper body, but wet shoes, you can't really go very far. I should have gotten rain boots, sort of booties before the trip, but I didn't. So this was a short day. Nevertheless, a short day of screaming at 40 miles an hour with water streaming everywhere off the wheels and stuff and hoping that nothing happened. Rain and Bambi next to what amounted to a freeway. So hopefully Bambi stayed there. This is part of the Erie Canal, a lift gate on the Erie Canal. This one's called Mountain Road. Fortunately, I'm at the right end of Mountain Road, about to go down. Here we are in capital of New York State, and then Massachusetts, the other liberal state. We have a lot of swamps there, a lot of ponds actually, with lily pads on them. It's beautiful, you should go, it's the best state. A lot of leafy green stuff. We have mosquitoes too, they're big. I didn't know we had houses like this, but we have that too. And, yep, proof, it was raining. Let's see. We have pizza in Massachusetts by Papagino's. And sometimes you have to cross defunct railroad tracks to get there, but it's worth it. Unless the rain picks up later on. And your last 12 miles or so are horrible. The road I took into Boston was pretty much the worst thing you can bike. It's Route 9. Nightmare, you get drivers pausing to let you know, you're crazy to be out here, you're gonna die. Well, I know, I grew up there. So this is Castle Island. Allegedly Edgar Allan Poe served here under an assumed name. So it's a five-bastion Civil War era fort. Let's see, there are a couple of them in Boston. There's one out on the island, but this is Castle Island where the soldiers who were involved in the Boston Massacre were temporarily housed. I think during the trial they would take them out to Castle Island. Right now it's actually a peninsula. They've built a causeway out to it. But this is near where I grew up in South Boston. Great aunt, not a cousin, not once removed, just great aunt. Nobody else is there for some reason on this day. You get to see what the rain gear looks like. Quite wet. They closed down the restaurant. It's really coming down dogs and cats. Oh, and you can see that I'm off the map at this point. This is just a strip of paper where I have my directions written. Yeah. Okay, there's that. Let's see how we're doing for time. Okay. Again, ask.
Did you have to ward off any wild animals, dogs, any dangers of that?
Dogs, definitely. Yeah, the first one I think was in Utah, a whole bunch in Kentucky. Kentucky is horrible. One thing that I would take is bear spray. Dogs, I think dogs like bear spray and they would enjoy it. I would enjoy it. I was I had five dogs converge on me in some middle of nowhere place, and they didn't bite, but you don't know that when they're a foot away. And if you go up a little bit of a hill, you can't outrun them.
What was the furthest distance you were away from ambulance service?
Easily over 100 miles. Yeah. So you're taking a risk in going out there, certainly. You can be 500 miles from the nearest mechanic of any sort or bike shop. So you need to carry some tools with you. Oh, anytime I stopped, there was a tornado warning. When I was in Kansas, if I was at a McDonald's, that's oftentimes where you're eating. There's not too much available some places. There would be tornado watches left and right. I ran into some people, three riders, a father and his two adult sons, and they were going the other direction. And they said, you know, if it starts to pick up, it can be quite sudden, and there's really no shelter. There might be a ditch. They just said, get in a ditch and lie down and, you know, lay your bike down and all that. Just hope for the best. So timing worked out. I was lucky enough. That's the best thing. You can have preparedness and you can have luck. You want to have a lot of luck on this kind of trip. So.
Yeah, thanks for a great show. You know, it just reminded me of doing IAP. I took a trip from Boston back to San Francisco here, but I crisscrossed the country.
Oh, nice.
Gray out, you know, not like...
Okay. You feel that ownership, it's true, but I like hard rock and heavy metal, so that's more what I say. Yeah, I've got a list of songs. I mean, Horse with No Name, I like that song. It seemed appropriate, but it didn't have the right rhythm. So uphill, I really wasn't singing. I just put it in a low gear, and I'm, you know, just going along, looking at the stuff, and it's exercise uphill. Downhill, it's got to be something with where the guitar sounds almost like a drums, just.
Or
4 days? Let me think. All right, so if it was day 13 that I took a break there. Day 4, I went over Carson Pass. So day 5, I went to Fallon. So yeah, day 6 until day 6, or a week. Week, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I went right across Utah, and so that was kind of a long trip. It's a big state. Ohio was another place where I spent about a week. Longest was 120 miles. That's my record. When I was in high school, that was the longest I had ever done, going up to New Hampshire and back. And shortest was about 51 days. I think that was day 4 when I went over Carson Pass. There may have been a couple of other short ones close to 50 or 60, mainly in the west, because after that there was no other stopping place for a while. And in the east, because it was pouring out and I felt miserable.
20 miles.
I would typically imagine about 10 miles per hour, because you're drinking water, you stop, maybe you think about your map a little bit, particularly in the air. Yeah. Take a little bit of a break. When there's a tree at the top of a hill, you try to send people a message on your phone. So you might be moving at a moving average of something like 12 miles an hour. But I'm a slowpoke. I'm really, really not in shape, just skinny. So I would say that could have been a 12-hour day, almost. Yeah.
What foods do you refuse to eat since being on the ride? How much weight did you lose by the time you got to the East Coast?
Sure. What we got here? There we go. So, orange juice, anything with citric acid in it. I would spend the first part of any ride, 10 miles or more, burping. Hot water is bad. That's what happens when you have it in those water bottles on my bike. I would put ice in there and it would melt in 5 minutes. In another 5 minutes, it would be hot. Let's see, I don't really like very fibrous granola bar type things. On the second one, I'm already lacerating my tongue from the harsh material.
And how much weight did you lose?
I think I got skinnier in the second half. I think I was less attentive to it, but I could probably have knocked as much as 10 pounds off. There were places I should have stopped in a Walgreens and used the scale, but I didn't. I had too many miles to do. Let's see, things on the road had to keep. So if I could get cheese in one of those gas station convenience stores, that would be good. But otherwise, Slim Jims or some kind of sausage type thing, nuts, M&Ms with peanuts were a big thing. Drinks, anything cold I could get. The shakes, milk, love milk. I had powdered milk on the bike with me too. Fierce Grape Gatorade, it's the only Gatorade I'll drink. Some of the others don't have flavor. There was one town which had two restaurants and they were both closed when I got there at 3 or something. So all I had was 4 cans of Pepsi out of this machine, but they were cold. I don't normally drink tonic or soft drinks. Let's see, and off the bike it was mainly normal food, whatever restaurant was available.
Did you get any wear and tear on your joints or anything that you had to deal with for your back?
Yes, there was the area that I was really concerned with before the ride was my knees. I do have bad knees. But as it turns out, if your seat is the right height, that does a lot to mitigate that and really make it go away. And I would take it easy every day. The first hour and a half or 15 miles every day, I treat it as a warm-up. Just take it easy, make sure everything's working smoothly. If something hurts, change an angle a little bit. If the seat is too high, your leg is kind of stretched out and the back will hurt. If it's too low, most people have it too low, the front starts to hurt, you're too crunched up. Now, what really was almost a showstopper was my hands. My hands started hurting a week or two into it, and they got very numb. Just that pressure, and there are only so many positions you can put your hands in, that I had numbness for months after the trip. So that was a real risk, that potential nerve damage. There's not much you can do about it. Maybe my second time across, I'll go slower, take some more breaks, kind of squeeze it a little bit to massage it. But the hands, and it kind of worked its way up into the shoulders a bit. If you look on the web and talk to doctors, there's not too much you can do. It's a kind of a repetitive stress thing.
Do you need handlebars maybe like that where you have several positions to choose from?
I would say so. Of the three general types of handlebars, they're the straight mountain bike kind of handlebars. I wouldn't go with that. I would do this or some kind of a mustache bar where maybe it comes back like that or curves in some funny way. With more positions, it helps a little bit. Yes, I have toe clips, but I have pretty much ordinary flat sneakers. Partly because shortly before.
Didn't have any feet problem, even when it got wet and rain.
Not really. The toe clips hold the feet in position quite well. With the rain, I guess it didn't have enough time to affect my feet. I'm actually wearing toe socks under these too, and they keep your toes separate. It looks like a glove for your foot.
Just a follow-up. What about the butt?
Butt was fine. I find that first ride of any year, my butt is sore. But by the next time, you get used to it. I also have an ergonomic saddle with a cutout there. I wouldn't ride any other kind of bike. I don't know, because some people like Brooks saddles. Maybe you can sort of settle into those. But it's really great not to have that pressure there. And more engineer stuff. But if you measure the bones in your butt, it's about 4 inches apart. That's really all you need. You don't want a big fat saddle, because it actually impacts the back of your thigh on the downstroke and gets in the way. You could get some soreness there just from having too wide a saddle. So,
apart from the gear, how much did your trip end up costing?
Let me see. Apart from the gear, that's tough. You can do it very, very cheaply. If we say the average motel, when I stayed in motels, could be $60. I stayed in one or two places that were $30. Some camping places are free. Some were $5 or whatnot. You could do warm showers and you can stay with people. And there are a lot of friendly people out there who are willing to host bicyclists. So that part of it, $40 to $60 a day plus a little bit of food. call it 60 a day times 50 days or so. Yeah. Those are the shoes. One thing that I found for shoes is when you're pushing too hard and it feels like the gears are biting into your soft rubber shoes, downshift, go into an easier gear. And your shoes will last you 4,000 miles of pedaling there. Again, they're normal shoes, but they're a little bit wider toe box, so they're shaped like a human foot with four toes. There's only one company I know that makes them. I've never ridden, well, maybe once I rode with bicycling shoes that have clipless pedals. But I looked at them, and I kind of didn't have time to test them out before the trip. It was really down to the wire those last 2 months getting ready. And it seemed that they were too narrow in the front, and that seemed uncomfortable for, 8-12 hours of pedaling. Go ahead.
If you would do it again, would you go with the panniers or would you take a trailer?
I would go with the panniers. I was very happy with my setup and with my equipment. I have actually the equipment list here and all that, but I was very pleased with how that worked out. I wouldn't want to deal with the idea that I could jackknife somehow. But I think I could get enough on the bike and have what I needed.
38, did you have any medical checkout before you went, teeth and such?
No, just normal checkups. I suppose it was probably December, so 6 months beforehand. Yeah, nothing special in that department.
So were you able to shed any part of what gear you carried at any point, like ship something back off, like you weren't going to use any more cold weather stuff?
Well, a little bit of chilly nights, but partly my ego after I got to the point where I didn't need it any longer. I'm gonna go all the way with all the weight. I carried less water in the east because there are places you could get more water. So the bike went down from 85 pounds fully loaded to maybe as low as 73 pounds. So yeah, the new bike, I bought it just before the trip. $900. New equipment, you could shave some things off of that. I bought a tablet for the trip. That was $250. I bought an air mattress and sleeping bag, all that. So all these things are $100 plus a very lightweight winter jacket that I could pack small. That thing was one of the most expensive items, probably $150-ish. So if you own things, you can cut down on the price. What else? Have a lot of gears on your bike. Have a triple chain ring in front, three gears in front. And then this bike is a 27 speed, so it's got nine gears in back. I didn't have to use the easiest gear until, I think it was day 14 or so. So not till 2 weeks in, not till Utah. But it's nice to have that margin. And I could stay seated to go over any of the mountains with these gears. I never had to stand up to bear down on the pedals. I think that's probably bad for your knees too, standing up. So yeah. Don't wear cotton clothes, wear this stuff. No underwear with this, okay? It traps your sweat, it traps the salt, it tends to wrinkle if it's cotton, and rubs against you, you get saddle sores. This allows the water to wick away, cools you off. Really intelligently designed. I didn't own all this getup before the trip. It was part of the day-by-day experiment of this ride. So. Let's see, here's why some people ask, why would you go alone? It's hard to find people to go with you.
Getting back to your clothes.
Yes.
In a humid area,
yep.
What do you do about the perspiration? Because we just found ourselves just taking shirts off all the time and replacing them, and you just had the one shirt that I think you rode with.
Yes. I'm really fanatical about sun protection, and I'm just really fanatical in general. So I keep it on. I don't care. But I'm hydrating all the time, having some Gatorade with the electrolytes, so I'm replenishing the salts. I'm also eating Slim Jims, which have salt in them. And it was really sweaty and hot in some Kentucky. It's pretty bad. You endure it, and get a little bit of wind. It's sometimes, yeah. I was lucky enough that it didn't really get cold, but maybe I would have appreciated a little bit of coldness. I could put some other clothes on if I needed to. But yeah, sure. Go ahead.
If you were to
leave the same time of year, or would you move it up or back?
If I took this route, I would leave the same time of year. You can't leave too early because Carson's Pass might have snow in it. You can't leave, well, you don't want to leave too late because it's just getting hotter and hotter. So you have about a 2-week window if you're taking the Western Express route across Nevada, when you want to target that 2-week window, end of May, second half of May or right at the beginning of June, I would say. It says on the adventure cycling maps where there are different resources. They're really great. They show you where there are camping sites, motels and whatnot, and bike shops. That said, I typically only looked one day ahead, okay? And you know, I didn't want to see the rest. Part of completing a trip like this is you do one day at a time. And you just, you know, you don't want to say, I still have 3,000 miles to go. It's just, tomorrow I'll do this. That's it. No, never. Yeah. 7 liters, or to almost 2 gallons. That was the heaviest thing on the bike, apart from me. It's about 15 and a half pounds of water.
How did you get back home?
I flew back. So I went to a bike shop and I had them send the bike back. They unpacked it a little bit. And then I got rid of my stove fuel and I ate up the remaining dry food, and I managed to pack everything so that I think I could carry it all on by shoving the yellow bags into the red bags and carrying my helmet separately. So I was surprised I could compress it all. Yeah.
Did you ever lose track of time?
Not really. I felt that I was in the moment the whole time. I mean, I really looked around a lot. I know some people that I met on the road, they kind of zoned out, or they said they would like to have a radio, but I didn't find that was a problem. I'm always thinking about managing the bike, looking at the road. There are rumble strips along these great Nevada roads, otherwise they're great, really wide shoulder, but there's a rumble strip right there, so way to the right or way right out in the lane. Yeah. So I was pretty focused and alert for it all. Back there? Sure. It was 5,000 something feet. It was about a mile. That wasn't the hardest. The hardest was early in the trip going up Carson's Pass. So four days from here. Partly because I wasn't ready for it in a way. Back there again. Yes, sir.
How did you do the shopping for your food across the trip?
Let's see. I had some dry food in the bike ahead of time. That was sort of my emergency reserve. Anytime I was in a town, I would go to a convenience store, whatever was available, and I only needed a few things during the day. Again, I had that backup food in case I got stuck somewhere or was camping. And I would eat at a restaurant whenever it was available. One town had nothing. You just you set up your stuff in their town green. You saw almost nobody. They had a couple of spigots where you could get water without contacting any other person, and there I ate my camp food, and the next day I rode for quite a long time before getting to, I think the town was called Eads, and there I put away a whole pizza and a half gallon of juice, and it's ridiculous how much your stomach can handle, but yeah. Sir?
My friend and I talk about finding road bounty. We call it road bounty, riding along and then finding things along the side of the road.
Okay.
Interesting thing you found?
I like nature, so it's animals, alive or otherwise. There are lots of suicidal lizards that just seem to be right there. I would dart this way and then they would run under me. But I don't think I ran any over. So for me, it's mainly the animals. I was happy I didn't see wolves, bears, cougars. I didn't see any of those. That was fine. But marmots and the prairie, the ground squirrels were really great. The birds were nice. Yep. Yes.
How did you decide whether to camp or stay in a motel?
I tended to lean towards motels. Maybe 20% of the time, 25% of the time I was camping. But I tried to go to the motels because I had this fantasy that they would have washing machines. So, And it takes really long with the camping because your tent has condensation inside of it. Your sleeping bag may be wet from that. Maybe you sweat a bit. So it takes you an extra hour in the morning to pack it all up. Sun is already up. It slows you down that way. So.
What kind of spare parts did you bring?
Two tubes, miscellaneous nuts and bolts, patch kit. You can see the pump that I have on the bike there. What else? Maybe not too much else. Mainly the tubes for the metal tools for tightening this and that. When you get new panniers, you're supposed to tighten the bolts 1,500 kilometers. Sorry, I don't know. Indeed.
Brake pads?
Yes.
No? Either at the beginning or the end, did you have people you stayed in contact with?
Yes, I had.
Every 2 weeks that are monitoring your progress?
Yes, I had some people following me on Facebook and whatnot. Some awesome people. Rode all the way out to Nevada, 500 miles of driving to meet me around Austin and Ely, Nevada, and then drove back to the Bay Area. Two of my friends.
The girlfriend you had before you left, is she still your girlfriend?
Yes. Yes. And she visited me at several points on the trip, so she's so much better she's also awesome. So we met in St. Louis. So some of my breaks corresponded to when we met. So St. Louis, and we saw Cahokia and all that, and a couple of other places.
What was your favorite place or the most surprising place you saw?
Let's see, I'm a big ancient history buff, so all of those Indian sites, Cahokia, St. Louis Arch, stunningly beautiful. For natural beauty, it was out west. It was Capitol Reef National Park. Yeah, they're the main ones.
So when you go up to the St. Louis Arch, how do you secure your bike when you go up there?
I never had any problems. That was when I was with my girlfriend. We actually rented a car for there. I mean, she dropped me where I stopped the riding and picked up the same place. But I never had any problem taking my bike into a motel. So that's when we're at a motel. So, yeah.
So then you're saying there was no hitchhiking at all across the U.S.?
No. No, that would be completely cheating.
I don't know if there's any advantage between going west to east or east to west.
Let's see. Starting in the east, you don't immediately have these steep mountains. So maybe you get to build up your strength. From the west, theoretically, you would have the wind pushing you, but no. Not really. I just took the route that was sensible for me. I live here, and I used to live in Boston, and I wanted to go there, so figured out that way. Yeah. Oh, Narem and Alberto. Yes, so some more transcontinental riders. Of course, if you take 12 hours the way some of us do, you get it at the beginning and end of the day. You'll get it somewhere. Most of it was in person. REI, I really discovered how great REI was in all this because they show you what the weight is for a lot of things, and that helps. All this get up except for the shoes is REI and the gloves, that's somewhere else. I caught a lot of sales and was quite lucky that way. The rear bags, the panniers, they've been across the country twice. I bought them from somebody I worked with. So. But it was mainly in person, some bike shops around here in REI. There are two places you can buy this kind of touring bike, Market Street Cycles and Nomad Cyclery out in the Sunset. Yep.
Do
It's a Jameis Aurora. It's a 2013 Jameis Aurora. Well, if you have time, just take a lot of bike rides in the Bay Area. Start out flat on the Iron Horse Trail in the East Bay. Ride to a bunch of towns in your own neighborhood. Get that book, Short Bike Rides in and Around San Francisco. Some of them are beautiful. There's one called Planet of the Apes Road that has an abandoned road by Devil's Slide. There's another abandoned road up by Martinez, where you're kind of up on the cliffs above the Carquinez Strait. Take the ferry out to Mare Island, out to Vallejo, and then go to Mare Island there. You can go through the Heritage District in Vallejo, see the nice buildings in Benicia, cross the Carquinez Bridge or the Benicia Martinez Bridge. Just do a lot of rides and have a lot of fun with it. Use the public transit to make the rides short enough that you can handle them, BART, ferries, Caltrain. You can do the route around the bay, just piecemeal, just to build up your mileage, I would say. Do some aerobic exercise, I guess, to put yourself in the mindset of going fast enough. I live in San Francisco. I wasn't sure if I could handle these steep hills. I took my old bike, which is geared such that it's twice as hard to pedal uphill as this one. So I took that up, up Knob Hill on one of the steep streets, which is like 24% grade. So I did that once or twice without stopping. In one stretch, I'm panting at the top. But maybe do a few steep hills just to see if you can do it. But ride a lot and just see a lot of the beautiful things around here. There are a whole bunch of these huge bridges that you can cross. Golden Gate Bridge, Dumbarton Bridge. Here's the East Bay, the Iron Horse Trail. When you get up in Marin, you can see the bridge from the west. On the East Bay, there's a nice park in Oakland. You can see East Bay Bridge. Carquinez, when you're crossing Carquinez Bridge, you can see this part of the bridge, which engineers, well, they checked that connection after it was fabricated. Let's see, up by Mare Island, this is a Sears Point Bridge. You can't cross that, but you can get a nice sunset. Mare Island Strait. Dumbarton Bridge is great. Big wide sidewalk for you to go across safely. But yeah, just do a lot of riding. So let's see, we can continue asking questions, but maybe if some of you want to come up and just feel what the bike is like physically, that would be great. I'm more than happy to have you actually pick up the bike. It's 85 pounds or so, 84, I don't have the tent on it. Sorry, 81, 80 right now. Oh, I'm going to unpack it right now.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. Before I unpack it, if a few people want to come up and actually feel what a touring bike feels like, feel how it feels cumbersome at first. The first time I loaded it up, it felt as if the bike frame would be too delicate for it. And then I rode it, and I couldn't believe that anybody would be able to ride a bike with all of this stuff. But very quickly, you get used to it, and it's pretty stable.